First up this morning, incredible footage out of Melbourne where police are on the hunt for a gang of masked teens believed to be behind a number of robberies right across the city.
Bottle shops and supermarkets have been targeted by the group in Burwood to Preston, Caulfield South and Keilor East, as well as multiple other locations.
Today's Christina Hearn is in Melbourne with the story. Chris, this has business owners really concerned.
Yeah, that's right, Carl, and also fed up, particularly those businesses that have been hit multiple times. This first piece of CCTV, you'll see these gang of masked teens enter into a bottle shop in Caulfield South. They're in and out in just a couple of minutes. A quick-thinking worker did manage to hit the panic button, but still, this gang took off with $5,000 worth of stolen goods. In the second piece of CCTV, you can see the same gang enter into an IGA in Preston. Once again, they're in and out in just a couple of minutes. This time, they take off with $15,000 worth of cigarettes. It is believed, police believe, that this gang is responsible for hitting up 14 supermarkets and bottle shops across the city in the past week. And it is understood they could have been out on bail at the time.
The idea that somebody who's already on bail and then commits a really serious offence doesn't face a tougher test for bail, that doesn't make sense either.
Business owners are now calling on the government to fix the state's bail laws. Carl?
Christine, thank you.
Sydney is once again waking up under a thick haze of smog this morning with a health alert issued as firefighters catch up on hazard reduction burns ahead of bushfire season. Poor air quality is being recorded in large parts of the city, authorities urging Sydneysiders to limit outdoor activity and keep windows closed. Breaking overnight, a truck driver has made a very narrow escape after his truck collided with a guardrail on the New South Wales Central Coast along the M1 Pacific Motorway. The impact caused an explosion before 9:30 p.m. Gas bottles and debris scattered across the road, shutting down all three northbound lanes for several hours. Amazingly, the driver only suffered minor injuries. Heart-stopping vision has emerged from Friday night's horror crash on Melbourne's Bourke Street, and the moment a car barrels through the intersection, missing an innocent pedestrian by just centimetres. There are fresh calls this morning for improved safety standards, with experts now asking for extra bollards to block cars from entering the shopping strip. Also new this morning, authorities are investigating the cause of a blaze which consumed a two-storey home at Talibudjara on the Gold Coast. The inferno started just after 10:30 p.m. Four fire crews battling the flames for over an hour. Investigations are continuing this morning.
As the death toll from Morocco's devastating earthquake rises to more than 2,500, authorities are this morning treating the injured in field hospitals. Nine correspondent Edward Godfrey joins us from Esselde near the quake's epicentre. Edward, you saw firsthand the enormous medical response.
Yeah, I have, Sarah. We've spent today inside that military hospital set up right near the epicentre. We were the first international media granted access to film inside of there. And as of just a short time ago, despite only becoming operational this morning, they treated more than 400 patients. While we were there, a steady stream of people kept coming in, some with very serious injuries, others with psychological trauma. Many of them have been injured for days but couldn't be reached or couldn't be found. We spoke with one man who had a head injury trying to get his family out of the house as it came down around them. Fortunately, he was able to do that despite suffering that head injury himself. I also spoke with the military colonel in charge of the set-up hospital, who told me a little bit about that experience there.
خصوصاً الأطفال والناس المتقدمين في السن.
So most of those people, they're suffering from psychological trauma. And fortunately, in this unity, we have a department. So they have many, many people working on this.
We spent a second day visiting other villages around the epicentre that have been so devastated by this quake. Many people are homeless, camped out in the streets. We saw them salvaging what they can from their crumpled homes. The search for survivors continues, although the window is rapidly closing. The death toll is now up over 2,700, and authorities haven't told us how many people are missing, so there are concerns that that could rise significantly yet. But despite all the heartache and the hardship, as you can see around us here, the community spirit is very strong.
Yeah, incredible work there amongst such devastating scenes. Edward, thank you.
America has this morning stood still, pausing to remember the events of the 9/11 terror attacks that killed nearly 3,000 people 22 years ago. Let's go live to 9US correspondent Alison Petrowski. Ali, somber scenes across the country this morning.
Yeah, and the largest of the ceremonies that we just saw there, Brooke, good morning to you, was taking place at the World Trade Center Memorial in New York City this morning, where victims' families gathered alongside US Vice President Kamala Harris and also alongside Rudy Giuliani, who was the New York mayor at the time of the attacks. Several moments of silence this morning to mark when the planes hit the World Trade Center, when the Pentagon was attacked, and also to mark when Flight 93 was hijacked, Brooke. Families reading out the names of almost 3,000 men, women and children that were killed in the 2001 attacks. Another remembrance ceremony also took place this morning at the Pentagon, led by the US Secretary of Defense, Lloyd Austin, who we can see on our screens. But Brooke, let's see one of the most moving moments from New York this morning, when two young boys paid tribute to their uncles, who they never met.
Uncle Noel, I'm so proud to be named after you. I love hearing stories about you, and I try to follow your example, showing kindness to everyone I meet.
And my uncle, Richard Michael Caggiano. Even though we never met, I always wonder how good of an uncle you would have been. I will always love you, and you will always hold a special place in my heart.
Yeah, two beautiful tributes there this morning, Brooke. And today's focus was really about incorporating children into the ceremonies to make sure that this day, that these lives are never forgotten. Brooke.
Absolutely. All right. Thanks, Ali. Well, two of the world's most talked about leaders could be just hours away from meeting with Kim Jong-un, understood to be on his way to Moscow for a summit with Russian President Vladimir Putin. This green and yellow armoured train spotted heading towards Russia is similar to what the North Korean leader has been seen travelling on in the past. The meeting between the two leaders could take place as early as tomorrow. The Prime Minister has gone on the attack after copping a grilling over his relationship with former Qantas CEO Alan Joyce. Let's go to Nine's federal politics reporter Rhys D'Alessandro in Canberra. Rhys, good morning. Questions are mounting.
Brooke, for the government, the Qantas-Qatar problem is a headache that won't go away, and for the opposition, it is the gift that keeps on giving. The Prime Minister, fresh from a successful Southeast Asian summit trip, back in the hot seat in Parliament, his government under fire over its decision to block additional Qatar Airways flights to and from Australia. Now, the opposition argues that call was less about the interests of Australian customers and more about the interests of Qantas. Both the Prime Minister and his Transport Minister, Catherine King, have repeatedly denied that, but the questions are continuing and they're now going to the details of the relationship between the PM and Alan Joyce. Specifically, the Prime Minister was asked whether the former airline boss ever dined at the Lodge or Kirribilli House and whether Alan Joyce had ever flown on a government plane. The Prime Minister vehemently denying Mr. Joyce had dined at the Lodge or Kirribilli, but he was forced to re-explain a government flight to last year's Jobs and Skills Summit after an event in Sydney. Mr. Joyce, as well as chief executives from BHP, Rio Tinto, Coles, Wesfarmers and the Business Council, flew on the PM's plane to Canberra, Mr. Albanese insisting they all paid their own way. And Brooke, this was no secret at the time. In fact, I can tell you there were jokes in the room about the former Qantas CEO being more likely to get his bags back with the RAAF than with his own airline. On the issue of Qatar, Brooke, there are some questions remaining and customers deserve cheaper flights, but at this stage of the debate, mudslinging's probably part of the reason the water isn't clear.
All right. Thanks, Reese.